Good afternoon, everyone. How you doing? Yeah, it's a great turnout today. How many Laker fans out there? Clippers? Yeah, Clippers. Tonight's the battle for the Pacific, so it should be exciting. Well, I'm very grateful to all of you for coming to our last What Matters to Me and Why of our 11th year. It's been a wonderful year having all of you here. And before we introduce our speaker, I just want to shamelessly plug a few events and also wish everyone out there a happy Holy Week and Passover. So for those of you who are interested, tomorrow we're hosting Professor Zachariah Mampilly. He's going to be talking about Africa on violent and nonviolent revolutions. It's going to be tomorrow, Thursday at noon. There'll be a free lunch, SOS B40. Next week on Monday, for those of you who knew and loved Chuck O'Regan, who served as one of the directors of facilities management here for over 30 years, you may know that he recently passed away. We're going to hold a university memorial service. It's open to everyone at 9 a.m. at Bovard on Monday, April 9th. Also next week on Thursday, April 12th, we're hosting a very interesting event called What's Going On Now. It's celebrating the 40th anniversary of Marvin Gaye's seminal album, What's Going On, a classic album dealing with issues of race and environmental justice and spirituality. It'll be at 5 p.m. at Alumni Park. It's basically a listening party, and we're doing it in association with the Kennedy Center in Washington, D.C. So bring a picnic, hang out in Alumni Park at 5. We'll have special guests talking about the significance of the album, and then we'll play it in its entirety. On April 17th, which is Tuesday, at noon at Heritage Hall, we're doing a spirituality and sports event on running, and there's also a free lunch there, and we're featuring Give Running, the student organization at USC. And finally, on 4/18, Wednesday, 2 weeks from today, we're hosting the world's most famous Hindu guru, Sri Sri Ravi Shankar, at Davidson. It's free for the USC community. We'll have him in conversation with a number of filmmakers on the issue of cinema and consciousness and human values. So we hope to see you at all those events. We're very grateful that you've come to our year here at What Matters to Me and Why. And now it gives me a great pleasure to introduce the student who will introduce our speaker. Please join me in welcoming Alejandra Vargas Johnson.
Hello. I'd like to welcome Dr. Veronica Terriquez, a distinguished professor, innovative researcher, and dedicated mentor to What Matters to Me and Why. Professor Veronica Terriquez received her Ph.D. in sociology from UCLA. She uses mixed methods in her research, often incorporating GIS maps, interview data, and empirical analysis, and teaches these tools to her undergraduate research methods course, which I took my sophomore year, and that's where I began my relationship with Dr. Veronica Terriquez. She is now my mentor for my sociology thesis. So, Terriquez received a grant from the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation to conduct the California Young Adult Survey. As principal investigator to the survey, she has overseen a team of graduate and undergraduate students who have surveyed over 2,500 young adults in California and have completed over 400 in-person interviews. She has been a community organizer in grassroots campaigns for education justice since her years as a sociology undergraduate at Harvard University. She received her master's in education at UC Berkeley in community organizing. Her research interests include the link between civic and school-based engagement and labor union participation among Latino parents in Los Angeles. She is the director of the Chicano Studies Program at USC and coordinated USC's first Latino Student Empowerment Conference in January of this year. Let's give Veronica a warm welcome. Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for coming here on such a beautiful day. It's really an honor to be here. Okay, there, got it. It's really an honor to be here speaking to you, and it's really been a real honor and privilege to be a professor here at USC for 3 years now. It's my third year. So I've been here for 3 years, and I still wake up in the morning, and I can't believe it. It kind of feels like a dream. I grew up 15 miles east of here in the San Gabriel Valley, and USC, the Trojans, are the most popular university. So, you know, it was really incredible to get this job. And when I was first hired, like, everybody in El Monte, or half the people in El Monte, heard about it because my family's been there for a very long time. I'm the daughter of Mexican immigrants who entered this country illegally. And now I'm actually part of the 1%. You're probably thinking, no, she's not. She's not rich. People who know me know I'm not rich. But I am part of the 1% of Latinos with a Ph.D. And actually, it's less than 1%. And it seems somewhat surreal that I have the privilege of spending my days teaching and doing research on topics that I care passionately about. So what matters to me and why? Well, what matters to me is supporting social justice causes that fight for equal opportunities for immigrants, for low-income people of color, for gay people, for students here in the United States. And the way I do this is through my research and teaching. Specifically, I care about research that informs workers' rights, immigration reform, and student-led efforts for social change. And through my teaching, I aim to push students to think critically about these issues and what matters to them so that they can be informed citizens and act on issues that they care about. So why this matters to me is quite simple. I wouldn't be standing here in front of you if it wasn't for those who came before us who had fought for social justice. I am especially indebted to the civil rights activists of the 20th century who struggled for equal rights for people of color, for women, for people from low-income and working-class communities, and other underrepresented groups. So in thinking about what matters to me and why, I thought of all the people that I'm indebted to besides my family, besides my mentors, the people in the civil rights movement who fought for me and others like me to be here. And there are many people who I feel indebted to, but one person really stood out from the rest. And this person is Ella Baker. How many of you know who Ella Baker is? Raise your hand. Not Etta James. Ella Baker. Anybody? Ella? Okay, raise your hand high. Okay, so just a few people know who Ella Baker is. Okay, so here's a picture of Ella Baker. For those of you who've never seen her picture before, don't know who she is. This isn't Etta James, Ella Baker. I'm going to give this to somebody, pass around. So Ella Baker was a civil rights activist, African-American civil rights activist, who often worked behind the scenes training women, students, and workers to organize around civil rights and human rights causes for 50 years. She's important to me because I realize that many of the opportunities that I have had throughout my life would not have been possible if it wasn't for the successful grassroots organizing campaigns led by Ella Baker or the thousands of people she trained over a 5-decade period. She works alongside some of the more famous civil rights activists that I'm sure you know, like W.E.B. Du Bois and Martin Luther King, and she even mentored Rosa Parks, Bob Moses, and many others. Ella Baker was born in 1903 and died in 1986. Unfortunately, I never had the chance to meet her, but I realize that much of my work examines her legacy. My work looks at how everyday people, immigrants, workers, and youth employ the grassroots organizing techniques that Baker taught so many people, young and old. In her work, Baker was especially committed to developing the leadership of women who had the propensity of getting things done often behind the scenes. And she was committed to working with students who tended to show great courage and steadfast commitment to their cause. She was an educator who got people to think about the root causes of the injustices that they faced in their everyday lives. And she would give them the analysis and the civic skills to collectively demand change. One of Ms. Baker's famous quotes was, "Strong people don't need strong leaders." She firmly believed that the average person did not need to rely on some famous leader, particularly a male leader, to fight for them. She knew that people without money, without status, had the power within them to impact change when they worked as part of a collective. So how has Ella Baker's legacy impacted me?
To explain this, I have to talk about my father and how the civil rights movement created tremendous opportunities for my father. My father came to the United States in the 1960s. He left his village in Jalisco, Mexico, soon after my grandfather passed away from cancer. And my father came from a very large family, and sometimes there wasn't enough food on the table. So as a young man, my father decided to come to the USA so his siblings could eat. My father came to Los Angeles since we've had family here since the 1920s. My family was part of the wave of migration in the 20s that helped build the freeways and many of the construction projects here in Los Angeles. So when he got here, my dad found the type of work that you would typically find an undocumented immigrant today. He found restaurant work, day laborer work, and construction work. And he worked many hours. Sometimes he didn't get paid the minimum wage, and sometimes he didn't get paid overtime. And my dad loved to work overtime. And he wanted to send money back home to his family. So these are the working conditions experienced by many immigrants today, especially those who are undocumented, like he was once. And then in 1966, here in Los Angeles, there was a major historical event. How many of you here have heard of the 1996 Watts riots? Okay, so most of you have heard of the Watts riots. So the Watts riots resulted in part because of the conditions of inequality, including high unemployment, poor schools, and high levels of poverty. The causes of this riot in 1966 were similar to those that caused the uprising in 92. But back in 66, thanks to the organized civil rights movement, of which Ella Baker had helped build, there were some real proactive responses to the riot or unrest that aimed to deal with the root causes of racial inequality experienced by African American Angelenos, as well as the Latino population that was here at the time. And one of the outcomes of the uprising was that some of the highly segregated labor unions here in Los Angeles were forced to integrate. One of these unions was the United Steelworkers of America, which represented an almost all-white workforce at a soda can-making factory just on the other side of the 110 freeway. I think it's over there. So just on the other side of the 110 freeway, there was a soda can-making factory that was almost all-white. Well, thanks to the demand of the civil rights movement, the government orders forced the company and the union to integrate. And they were forced to hire African-American workers here from South L.A. and Latino workers from the East Side. And guess who got hired? My dad. Yay. So my dad got the opportunity to be part of a labor union at a time when unions were still strong. And so what did that mean for me? What did that mean for my brother, my mom, my dad's family back home? Well, for starters, we weren't poor. I wasn't like many of the other Mexican kids that I knew who were really struggling financially. My father earned a family wage, got paid overtime, and he got health benefits for all of us. So this means he could achieve the American dream. So having a father who got a decent wage really made a difference. And so you might be able to understand why supporting workers' rights really matters to me. My father earned enough money so that he could send my brother and myself to Catholic schools. We were solidly working class. I wouldn't say middle class because we were still on a tight budget. But we didn't have to attend the El Monte public schools, where at the time about 1 in 3 kids would drop out of high school. And so the public schools back then were underfunded, weren't adequately educating kids of color, in the same way that many of the public schools are not doing the same today. And so I was lucky to go to Catholic school, and I don't want to suggest that Catholic schools or private schools are the solution to a failing public school system in some cases, but in my case, I was fortunate enough to attend Alverno High School in the early 1990s, which was an all-girls Catholic school. And at that time, that school had a strong, unapologetic feminist leadership, and that really impacted who I was. It was quite a bit of a radical school. I mean, back then, Archbishop Mahoney was thinking about closing it down. or so they say. And so it was radical in the sense that, for example, when we read scripture or prayed, we referred to God as a woman. We used feminine terms. So imagine in the Bible when a reference is made to God and it says he, that turned into she. So when we prayed the our Father who art in heaven, that became our mother who art in heaven. And I remember seeing, I vividly remember the sticker on the wall of my English class that said, trust in God, she will provide. So here I was trained to look at history, literature, and even the hard sciences with a gendered analysis. This approach to learning probably propelled me to become a sociologist. It taught me to examine social behaviors through a critical lens. And at the same time, this feminist curriculum was really, really empowering. Women's histories, women's stories were infused throughout the curriculum. And I learned how women were systematically denied positions of power in the church, in the government, in business, in universities, and so forth. But at the same time, I also learned that these injustices could be changed. And it was a struggle of earlier generations of women, like Ella Baker, that really had changed the world for women, for people of color, and so forth. So at the school in history class is where I learned about Ella Baker. And I realized, you know, and I kind of took this for granted. I thought everybody knew who Ella Baker was, but obviously it's not the case. Women's history is still systematically erased from much of the curriculum in many schools. So I had the privilege of learning and being inspired by stories of Ella Baker and many others. And really, when I left high school, I really wanted to continue that legacy in my own way. But I, you know, I was 18 years old, so I didn't know how. So I had the privilege of going to Harvard for undergrad. And I must say, I owe my acceptance into this university in great part to the civil rights movement that fought for racial integration and affirmative action that diversified institutions of higher education. Harvard was a real eye-opening experience. I think for the first time, I had a real sense of what economic inequality meant in this country. So I really got to meet the real 1%, not, you know, 1% with a Ph.D. So I got to go to school with some of the 1%, and this was really eye-opening. And I, on an academic level, I really became interested in understanding some of the social inequalities that we see in the world around us. I became a sociology major and learned about the structural and historical causes of these inequalities, and I learned how to measure them. And that was a nerdy side of me, statistics. But in sociology class, I learned about the inequalities, but I didn't really know how to go about changing the oppressive conditions that some people experience in the workplace, in their schools, and in their communities. So I was like, okay, well, there are these problems, and we need to go change it. So in thinking about Ella Baker, and I always, like, I carried Ella Baker with me in my heart. I was thinking, okay, I want to do something, you know, power to the people, let's go change things. So I just moved to Oakland, and I became a community organizer. And some of the campaigns I worked on were around education justice. I worked with parents, African-American parents, immigrant parents, refugee parents from Mexico, El Salvador, Vietnam, Cambodia, and other places to make the public school safer and more responsive to low-income families. I also worked on campaigns with high school kids, some of them who had gang ties or family challenging family circumstances, some of who just had arrived in this country recently. And I worked with these kids to revamp unfair disciplinary practices at school. At one high school, at the school that I worked in, there was, you know, about one in two African American boys were being systematically suspended, and Latino and Polynesian kids were not faring much differently either. So I worked with these students to revamp the school discipline policies, and they decided that they really wanted to create a major change at the school, and they wanted to open up a youth center that would help students like themselves who weren't doing well in school, who were having family challenges, who wanted something fun to do also after school. And the students decided that they wanted to open up a youth center that provided a range of activities. And so I said, okay, we'll do this. So what this entailed was organizing parents, teachers, neighbors to try to support this youth center. And a group of high school kids would go to city council meetings, county meetings, school board meetings, and demand a youth center. And they won. They got commitments over $500,000 for this youth center, found people to staff the center, and they opened up what is now called the One Land, One People Center. So I got to, the firsthand experience of learning about the transformative role that grassroots organizing could have on people and on communities. Some of the young people that I worked with were at one point thinking of dropping out of school, were really disengaged. And these same young people later became leaders in their communities, leaders in their schools, and some even went on to college. So in seeing all this change, I was really excited, but I also realized that, you know, we still had a lot of work to do, and we still needed to better understand the social inequalities that impact the people in Oakland, the kids that I worked with, the families that I worked with. And so I decided to get a Ph.D. And I wanted to do research that informed the grassroots organizing efforts that it would address some of the challenges of the people like my family, people that I had worked with in Oakland, people that I had grown up with. So on an academic level, one of the first cases that I turned my attention to was the Justice for Janitors campaign led by the Service Employees International Union. The Justice for, so how, have people here heard of the Justice for Janitors campaigns? Okay, good. Some people have heard. So the Justice for Janitors campaigns were those that began in the late 80s and early 90s that fought for wages and improved working conditions of janitors. Now, this labor movement, which involved a lot of undocumented immigrants from Mexico and Central America, occurred at a very important moment in time. As I had mentioned earlier, my father had joined the labor union in the late 60s when the labor union still had a lot of power in this country. The unions of the 60s and 70s were still benefiting from the labor struggles of the 1930s and New Deal policies that conceded to the demands of organized labor. However, by the 80s, many of these unions had forgotten how to lead a good fight and effectively engage their members and potential allies in the struggle for workers' rights. They failed to develop the leadership of rank and file members. And they did not have people like Ella Baker training workers on how they should stand up for their rights. And on top of that, some of the unions were corrupt. So in the 80s, when the labor movement came under attack by the Reagan administration, it failed to effectively fight back. Workers were at a loss about what to do, and the labor movement did not develop the mass support of the American public. Labor had lost much of its credibility. And it had also lost membership as factories that employed people like my father moved south of the border eventually, or to China or elsewhere. And so this labor movement was really crippled. And so in the 80s, we were losing decent paying union jobs. And these jobs were being replaced by low-paying jobs. And this was occurring in a range of industries, but one of these industries was the janitorial industry, where employers began replacing union workers with often low-paid, often exploitable, undocumented immigrant workers. So in the 80s, late 80s and early 90s, SEIU started organizing the janitors. And they shocked the labor movement, which had assumed that it would be impossible to organize immigrants, immigrants who did not speak English or who might be afraid of being deported. So SEIU decided it would adopt the grassroots organizing strategies of the civil rights movement, some of the same strategies that Ella Baker had taught workers, students, and women, and many others. And they surprised many. They surprised the labor movement, they surprised the public, as thousands of janitors took to the streets demanding their rights, demanding to be recognized by the labor union. And so they were asking for the same rights that my father had 20 years earlier. And they even did this on this campus. Back in 1995, the subcontracted janitors at USC obtained wages and working conditions here on this campus because they organized. And so this led me to one of my first research projects that tested the legacy of Ella Baker. As a researcher, I became interested in learning how union organizing experiences enable janitors to resolve problems outside the workplace, specifically in their children's schools. And in writing about the janitor's case, I hope that I have illustrated how the organizing process empowers immigrant workers to resolve concerns that affect their families and affect their communities. So, another issue that I've been really, really interested in is looking at the organizing process in the immigrant rights movement. Today, there are an estimated 11 million or so undocumented immigrants living in the United States. And these are almost all hardworking, law-abiding people, people like my parents who came to this country to put food on the table. They were like people who came 100 years ago who also wanted to make ends meet. And, you know, sometimes we forget that this is a nation of immigrants. I want to see a show of hands here. Okay, how many of you are immigrants yourselves? Okay, so a lot of people are immigrants. Keep your hands up. How many of you have parents who are immigrants? Okay, and how many of you have parents or grandparents or great-grandparents who are immigrants? Okay, almost everybody put their hands up. Okay, so this is a nation of immigrants. But we have to think about differences between the experiences, let's say, that my parents encountered or your grandparents encountered and many of the undocumented immigrants today. So 100 years ago, it was pretty easy for an Italian immigrant, a German immigrant, to become a citizen. There was no line that required people to wait 15 or 20 years for legal entry, like there is today for immigrants from Mexico, El Salvador, and some other countries like the Dominican Republic. So if you come from certain countries, you really have to wait a very long time to come here legally. But this isn't the case for everybody. So if you come here, if you want to come here from Sweden or England, the wait is a lot shorter. So my point here is that I really care about research that can inform efforts to improve our immigration laws so that they're fair to everybody. My parents were here in the country illegally, but there were laws that enabled them to become legal once they proved that they were good, law-abiding, hardworking people. I personally believe that the same opportunity should exist for many of the people who are here and who are undocumented, hardworking, good people. So many of you may know this or maybe not, but LA is home to the largest immigrant rights movement in this country, and this movement is fighting for a pathway to legalization for undocumented immigrants. And much of this movement is led by women as well as by undocumented students fighting for the DREAM Act. So there's a really strong parallel between the civil rights movement of 50 years ago and the immigrant rights movement today, where women and students are kind of the backbone of the movements. And so I see a lot of parallels between Ella Baker's civil rights organizing today and the immigrant rights organizing that I am studying. Finally, I'm going to close up by talking about one more issue that matters a lot to me. And this is... Okay, so this is something that's really close to my heart. I've been really committed to figuring out what supports the civic engagement and activism of young people today. The students are the ones who are inheriting this planet and who could take informed action in shaping what it should look like. Ella Baker knew that young people, when empowered, were the group most creative when it came to finding solutions about issues that matter to them. And she knew that young people, students, would take the greatest risk in working towards what they believed in. And she saw this many, many times in her 50 years of organizing. I've also seen it through my own organizing work in Oakland, and I've also seen it through the research that I'm doing now through the California Young Adult Study. And so I have more pictures to show. There are many parallels between the student organizing 50 years ago and organizing being done today. I'm going to show a picture of African-American students demanding that colleges be desegregated in the South. I'm also going to show a picture of white students who are also fighting for the desegregation of restaurants in, I think, somewhere in the Midwest. And then here's a picture of undocumented students fighting for the DREAM Act, a path which will give them access to college and a pathway to legalization. And so, really, I'm often moved by the work of students who really are at the vanguard trying to change the world and trying to make it a better place. And so, I'm really committed to helping young people decide what matters to them and why. And I believe it's the responsibility of the older generation not to dictate what they do, but to give them the information and tools so that they can work for a better world, a world which they themselves imagine. So Ella Baker found inspiration for her organizing by working with many, many students. I, too, take inspiration from the younger generation. I never cease to be impressed by the new solutions they devise to address problems affecting their own communities. And I'm often moved by the sincerity and thoughtfulness of their convictions. Working with students has given me hope that our society will continue to move forward in treating different groups of people, minorities, gay people, working class people, other people with religious minorities, with respect and dignity that they deserve. It gives me hope that we will move forward towards a more just and fair society. And for this hope, I really thank you, the students. Thank you. Any questions? Monica.
I just had a quick question as far as undergraduate students who are now in the position you were in. Uh-huh. What kind of advice could you give us as far as like getting by when times get hard?
I think thinking about the bigger picture always is very helpful. We might have a hard time with our exams, or we might have financial difficulties. But in the end, it's just a minor challenge when you know that in the future you could be making a big difference. It's like I've always kept going, I keep on working, sometimes lose a little sleep, because I know that what I'm trying to do is contributing to what I believe is a greater good. And so that keeps me motivated.
To sort of insulate themselves from the lower working class by subcontracting that labor, such as janitorial services or boxing type things, and how that can be combated, because in a sense they're insulating themselves like from the PR connectivity and the ability to unionize, because you're not even talking about the company, you're talking about a subcontractor who can be like disappeared at a moment's notice.
Right. So I haven't studied exactly what it is that the companies do and who's doing it and what. But what I have looked at is the organizing strategies to circumvent that. So the janitors and other unions have really turned to public support to shame these companies, even though there's no legal relationship between, let's say, the janitors and the building owner downtown, like a large corporation downtown. What they do is they shame the owners so that they force the subcontractor to, or they give more money to the subcontractor so that they could pay the janitors better. It's not a legal battle. It's more of a public opinion battle. Right. So that's, in the past, unions had legal recourse, and many times they don't anymore. Jeff.
First, thank you for your talk. It was great. What advice would you give to current or future advisors and teachers of undergraduates? In terms of what kind of advice would you give to faculty about how to advise or how to instruct their students?
Oh boy. I think it's important to ask students what they want for themselves and then support them in achieving their goals. It's pretty basic, but yes.
Thank you very much for sharing. It was very inspirational and great to hear your insight. I think it's something that I've heard, at least from our generation, quote unquote, or I don't know if it's just a message that's been perpetuated, but that, you know, people don't care in the same way that they used to, and that they don't take as much investment in community issues, and people are a lot more apathetic towards really coming together and helping out their fellow man or woman, whatever, or what have you. So what advice could you give about how do you kind of combat either real apathy or at least the perpetuation that people are apathetic and don't care?
Well, I could talk about young people the best. young people are willing to work for their communities, are willing to make a difference, but they're not often asked. They're not invited. And so that invitation does not exist for many young people. And so, I mean, it is my belief that we have to do more to outreach to young people and ask them, what matters to you and how can I help you do something about it? So it has to do with social networks and people outreaching, especially to people from low-income backgrounds, because the opportunities to engage don't exist to the same degree. And some of that has to do with cutting public school programs that involve young people in community service, involve them in activities in their communities. So the public safety net really needs to be there to support civic engagement for young people, but also for adults as well. Community centers are facing budget cuts, and these are community centers that outreach to seniors, outreach to everyday working folks. Thanks.
I want to be more proactive about women's rights and being, you know, giving equality to everything. Do you have any suggestions? How my really masculine friends can do that without losing sort of this American image of how, you know, a really manly man does this and that?
They should listen instead of talk as much. Listen more, talk less. I mean, but that's great that they want to do something. So that's a first step. So I commend them for that.
You've successfully bridged the divide between academia and kind of civic engagement and social justice, and it's, I think, sometimes really hard to do that. What are your key success factors or best practices in that?
Well, whenever I take on a research project, I make sure that it matters to somebody outside of academia, and it's going to hopefully help some people, you know, at least provide information that's useful for people who are working with everyday folks.
How do you find out if it will?
Well, Ali, you've been there at meetings where we're with CIRLA, the Coalition for Humane and Immigrant Rights. When we develop surveys, we ask them, okay, well, is this information going to be useful for you? And how can we write this up in a way that's constructive, that provides information that informs what you're doing? Mm-hmm. And so the trick is to make sure, at least as a sociologist, to make sure that I'm doing something that's theoretically interested, that's going to inform the field of sociology, and at the same time has some practical implications in the real world. And because sociology addresses real world issues, I don't find it that difficult. Billy.
First of all, thank you so much for your talk. I had a question kind of following up on Sable, but I wanted you to talk more about student activism or the lack of at USC. However, in light of the rally, the great rally that was done for Trayvon Martin, and also other groups that have formed recently, like IDEAS, mm-hmm. the Undocumented Club. And then also, if you could speak briefly on your thoughts about the USC Master Plan. Currently, Mecha is going to be hosting an event next week to talk about the different impacts that that particular plan has. So I'm just curious about your thoughts on that based on your work.
Well, I think USC students are great. I mean, I love USC students, and I think that they will support causes that they believe in, whatever those may be, as long as there's an opportunity to do so and an organization to back them up. So organization like IDEAS or, you know, many of the organizations that operate out of El Centro or out of this organization that supports young people in addressing things that matters to them. As far as the master plan, I don't have enough information to comment, so I don't want to say anything without being properly informed.
You know, there was a consensus in this country forming in 2007 with the Kennedy-McCain bill that would have enacted the DREAM Act and mm-hmm. the pathway to legalization, et cetera, and now nobody even remembers what it is, and including McCain. So
McCain doesn't remember a lot of things.
So it's like, you know, but it strikes me that yes, obviously the Republican Party has been taken over by racist xenophobes. That's obvious. But now what? You know, how do you reach the? How do we? Isn't there a way to reach the moderate Republicans or?
Yes, there is.
Those people must still exist somewhere. How do we turn this around and get immigration reform? How do we actually do it?
So my answer may seem very simple, but a lot of that has to do with grassroots organizing, relationship building at the ground level, getting everyday people to understand the issue and how it affects them. The immigration issue affects white working class folks as it affects African-American working class folks, and there could be a way to resolve the immigration issue so that it lifts everybody up. When we have undocumented labor, it often undercuts wages for everybody, for working class folks, for African-American, for white working class folks. If we legalize people, it'll at least make it easier for people to get paid at least the minimum wage. And so those dialogues have to occur. And they're probably going to have to occur at the grassroots level. And so the immigrant rights movement has been working to do outreach into areas where those moderates live, and even the conservatives. Because conservatives also understand the market economy and, you know, how this might benefit not just the immigrants. And so that's going on, so, you know, and it's also going on, but it's behind the scenes a lot of times. It's not this big media event. It's on the ground grassroots organizing that worked for the civil rights movement and I think is really going to help the immigrant rights movement today. So I know we're running out of time, and I really want to thank everybody for taking the time to be here and for listening, and power to the people.
We want to thank you, and as a gift from What Matters to Me and Why, here's a journal for you to write what matters to you and why.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks.